Ladies and gentlemen, the Rolling Stones.
Some can say the Stones were at their peak in 1972 summer tour. Not touring since the infamous Altamont in December 1969, and then after they released the masterful Sticky Fingers and Exile albums. It was great for them to be out and about in 1972 summer and playing after being cooped up. They were on fire. Prime playing mode, so tight. 1 year of being in the south of France at Nellcote as one cohesive unit, writing, jamming, seaside resorts and relaxing, boating, living together, eating meals together, and getting high together, filled with drug addicts, drug buddies, and drifters. It was a magical and fluid rhythm going on there. June 3rd of 1972, also known as the start of the Cocaine and Tequila Sunrise Tour, or STP, Stones Touring Party. The North America tour started off in Vancouver. 2,000 fans tried to force their way into the Pacific Coliseum, leaving about 31 policemen injured. Couldn't handle it. This happened to be the first of several violent incidents that went on this tour. Keith can hardly even remember the tour. The band played fast and longer lengths of the songs. Keith said, well, that was probably catching up for lost time. They cannot escape the drama and dark moments of this tour. The drug slippage was very, very easy for Keith. In July in Montreal, dynamite exploded beneath one of the vans at the loading ramp around 3 a.m., destroyed most of the equipment, and a few people came up saying that it was them, but no one at all was convicted. People started speculating Hell's Angels or Quebec's separationists. Well, in Montreal at the Forum that evening, also 500 counterfeit tickets were circulating, causing some type of riot and commotions. Jagger was hit with a bottle also. The next day, when the band flew to a small Rhode Island airport after customs, Keith was exhausted. He decided to take a nap on the side of a parked fire truck. He was very groggy and started hearing and feeling light bulbs and flashes going off in front of him from a local photographer. And Keith just jumped up and he hit in the direction of the photographer and he kicked the photographer and the camera light and busted it. The scene just erupted and then the FBI gets involved. The photographer claimed he was assaulted. Keith was arrested, but Mick, Marshall Chess, and Bobby Keys demanded to be arrested also. Now, this was occurring just hours prior to the Stones having to go on stage at the Boston Garden that evening. In Boston that day, the mayor happened to deal with riots in the Puerto Rican neighborhood. And the fans at the Garden were getting extremely restless, and the mayor found out of the situation with the Stones having to show up to do the concert but being held up in Rhode Island. He said, let the fuckers go. I cannot have two riots to deal with here in Boston. The Stones were police escorted to Boston. They got there after 12 midnight, and they played. Never a dull moment, and just so much more pandemonium. Robert Frank, a Swiss filmmaker and photographer, followed the Stones on this tour, documented it to its fullest, all the backroom drama. He made a documentary called Cocksucker Blues. It was never released, as it couldn't be, because it couldn't even get a rating. It was so descriptive, filled with sideshow chaos. It became a cult film and only shown in special theaters. I happened to be lucky to get a glimpse of this in Boston in 1987, introduced by Robert himself. The STP tour ended in Madison Square Garden on July 26, 1972, Mick Jagger's 29th birthday. 48 shows in 54 days. So this documentary is about Goat's Head Soup. The meaning of the album, why it's made, how it's made, the songs, what they mean, what it's about, the studio drama, and the time that happened in between, and the commotions that happened to the Stones, the tours that they had in between, going to England, and some of the chaos that happened there, and then finally the release of the album. Also with this Goat's Head Soup Deluxe release, coming out September 4th, 2020, if you're watching this after, you know it's been released. Very special album, remastered. To the Stones fans, this is a great album. To the average fans, some don't care. But I'm going to try to influence you and see the beauty of this. The Stones were brilliant from 1968 to 1973 and even beyond to 1981. Mick Taylor's period was, I consider it, probably the best and creative. They had assistance with the unbelievable, talented producer, Jimmy Miller. Combination of all this, the chaos, the drugs, the marriages, the girlfriends, was a perfect storm for some great music and lyric writing. I'm now going to go back a little bit when the Stones just leaving France, leaving Nellcote to finish up the mixing and overdubs of Exile on Main Street before this tour. They took the raw material for Exile, no overdubs there, arrived in LA. They stayed for about 4 to 5 months. And they did their mixing and overdubbing on this beauty. And it was not advisable by the business to make double albums. Stones didn't care. They did it anyway. They had so much material and knew it was good. It was here in LA that the Stones would get radio stations and the Stones would sit in their cars over by Tower Records and listen to the songs while the radio DJ played it right at that moment. And they wanted to hear what it sounded like on the radio. It's pretty cool. And of course, when the single was over and played, the person that delivered it made sure they took it and left with it. Now, Keith was living in Stone Canyon with Anita. He had hooked up with Graham Parsons one evening and went to get some dope. Graham took Keith to the back alleys of L.A. They picked up some MSS, Mexican shoe scrapings. That's what they called it. Street shit, brown, bad, low-life crap heroin. Anyway, that would be the last time Keith would ever see Graham again. There's Graham and Keith on the motorcycle going through LA. Keith wanted to quit, but he could not get ready and prepare to tour in this condition. And his visa was running out in the U.S., so he had to split with a pregnant Anita and get cleaned up for the tour and be a little bit fresher. Anita was not as hooked as Keith was. So while in L.A., their Nellcote residence was raided also by the police, and they found stuff. It took a year to bring charges and get a warrant for the arrest for he and Anita. Keith couldn't go back to England, and those taxes were terrible, and they had tax issues, and they couldn't go back to France. So it was a quick decision made. They chose Switzerland to become their home. So upon arrival, Keith took an ambulance, went straight to the clinic to get cleaned up. He had to go cold turkey for 3 days. Actually, he did want to be drugged up for that. While in the clinic and recovering, he started writing a song and a melody. Angie, Angie. Not about any person specifically, but a random pick of a name. Now, simultaneously, a pregnant Anita was giving birth to their daughter right in the town. Anita picked Dandelion as the name, but the Catholic hospital she was in wouldn't accept it and wanted a proper naming, so she chose Angela, Angie, as the middle name. In October of 72, Mick, Charlie, Bill, they spent some time in London performing overdubs on records of the 72 tour for a never-released live album. We're still waiting for this. In early November, Mick records with John Lennon and Yoko in New York City at the Record Plant for Yoko's new album. Now, Mick at this point was in Bianca's high life. She couldn't make the adjustments to be in the Rolling Stones level, but Mick had to make the adjustment to be at her level, the high life world, the upper echelon, the trend setting, going to fancy parties, fancy dinners, fancy places, fancy people. Mick's bohemian life was shelved. He was now being called a jet setter and even got a small diamond put into his tooth. But Mick and Keith knew they were still part of the Rolling Stones and had to push and work on a new album and get new material. And they had to get the momentum moving ahead. They faced two problems, though. They could not record in England until 1973, and they couldn't record in France. Also, they had to find a new location now, where Keith could go without being harassed by authorities. In steps Ahmet Ertegun, Atlantic Records co-founder and U.S. distributor of Stones albums. He did research, and he found a studio in Kingston, Jamaica. Now, Mick and Keith visited Kingston and Jamaica for vacation, but never lived there, never absorbed the culture much, but just hung out. Booker T, Leon Russell, Paul Simon, there are folks that used the studio. And recently, Jimmy Cliff recorded The Harder They Come for the soundtrack there. Dynamic Sound was built in 1958 to help promote Jamaican music. The person who they asked to run it was Byron Lee of the Byron Lee and Dragonairs. He formed a band in 1950s and he was pretty successful. He'd taken over the running of Dynamic Sound and he still continued his playing also. Dynamic Sound became the heart and soul of ska and reggae. They were the Muscle Shoals of Jamaica. They did appear briefly in the James Bond filming Dr. No in Jamaica. There are many outtakes, many alternative versions. They've been bootlegged and circulated around. There are just so many. When the Stones laid down some of the songs for Goat's Head. The ones not on the album releases. It was not because they didn't like them, but these outtakes and other songs were due to the constraints and not having that luxury of time like they did with Exile. They are very pressured with time to squeezing these songs out. They just laid the songs down but never had the time to polish them up and move ahead. This is why they surely have a few more albums that they can be released with older selections here. However, time's still a factor and not on their side due to their age. So they gotta clean these up quickly. When they went to Jamaica, everyone thought they were going to do a reggae album. But they didn't want to do anything with the reggae music at that time. More important, Keith thought that they were not capable of playing it the way it should. They didn't have enough experience. They didn't get really to live the culture and integrate into their environment. Now, Andy Johns was sent 2 months earlier to case the location and prepare the studio for the Stones' arrival. So when he got there, the work area was good, but the control room was not at all the state of the art. No sound screens to separate the musicians. Speakers were strangely placed. There was no grand piano or a Hammond B3 organ. They didn't use headphones either. And some of the equipment was second rate. So Byron had agreed to provide improvement. He actually flew to Miami and purchased about $100,000 worth of new equipment. He upgraded from an 8-track to a 16-track, newer technology. However, upon the Stones' arrival, they were still missing some of the features and promises. They eventually got there, but towards the end of the sessions. They move real slow down there, is what Andy said. One note was the amps and drums in the studio, well, they were nailed down to the floor. But the Stones brought in their equipment. And as mentioned, Exile was a fantastic environment for unity and closeness. And going into Goat's Head sessions, well, it started feeling strange. The vibe was missing. Mick and Keith was distant. But also, there was a disastrous ingredient going on. Again, heroin. Jimmy Miller, Andy Johns, Mick Taylor, they were strung out. Keith knew that what they were in for. Keith said, "You were supposed to do as I say, not as I do." The band and crew shared a hotel in Kingston. An old mansion, Terra Nova. They ate breakfast together, but again, they didn't have the closeness that they had in Nicolette. The Stones would book the studio for a month straight, 24/7. This way they just leave everything as is. They didn't have to worry about it the next day for setting up. They would develop their songs in a very free format approach. Few lyrics, working on rhythms, jamming and jamming, repetition while the sound was being fixed. A bit boring to some. Now, Ian Stewart would usually normally kick off the warm-up sessions playing some 12-bar blues licks, and they would all kick in. Now, Mick said about finding something to eat was a problem. We usually got up too late for lunch and too early for dinner. When we return from the studio, it's usually too early for breakfast. Bill remembers arriving at the studio and their security guard would sit at a fence, but he would be sitting there with a shotgun. Nicky Hopkins arrived with the band, but he only stayed for 2 weeks. He had his own solo album to do. Billy Preston, he flew in from L.A., but for the last 2 weeks of the recording. Now, sometime into the session, a man with a knife broke into Bill's hotel room while he and his girlfriend, Astrid Lundstrom, were in there. The man demanded money. He also demanded Astrid. He had Bill go hide under the bed while he raped Astrid. After Andy got a knock on his door from Astrid while Bill was still hiding under his bed, she told him what just happened and about the rape. They went looking, but the rapist was long gone. Bill was still under the bed, frozen. If Bill would have moved, he probably would have been sliced open. He had no choice. Bill and Astrid moved to another hotel, but the sessions continued. They had to. This could have contributed to Bill's absence in some of the songs, and also a little bit of the band's losing some energy. Pretty horrible story. The energy loss was pretty obvious, and there were times when there were substandard basic tracks that were being laid down as they were just being accepted as it was. This was also had to do with being too high too often. But then again, there were many other brilliant signs on this album. This is what Andy Johns had mentioned. Jimmy Miller had said the sessions were out of sync, and at times they seemed to be falling in pieces. He saw Mick and Bianca not getting along, Bianca and Anita not getting along, while Mick and Keith had to try to focus and pull it together. It seemed like it was either a Keith or Mick song being created and less a collaboration. As mentioned at Nicolette during Exile, there was a lot of issues, a lot of bad people, as I mentioned, drifting in and out, stealing ex-Stones employees that were very disgruntled employees. They were fired. A lot of things going on. And these employees basically complained to the police and exposed the Stones. So what happened on December 4th, in the middle of the sessions, Mick, Charlie, Bill, and Mick Taylor, they had to fly to Nice, France to answer questions at an informal investigation due to these allegations. And the judge asked them many questions of knowing certain people and if they ever used drugs, especially heroin. And Mick said, no, never did. Now, Keith and Anita, however, they had arrest warrants out for them and issued. And these, of course, had to do with the Nicolette. And what happened was two men who were at Keith's house at a party got arrested. They got caught. And they basically said, well, we just came from Keith's house. Well, the story got so discombobulated and the police were so unorganized. But all they knew what they wanted to do was bust Keith. So, he had to have a arrest warrant out for him. December 6th to the 13th. Well, the Four Stones flew back to Kingston, and they had to finish up the sessions. And of course, this whole departure and coming back sort of deflated the momentum in the sessions, and things started going real slow moving. December 14th, finally, Bill, Mick Taylor fly to the Bahamas for a holiday. Keith and Anita, they stay in Jamaica, and they go to the North Coast in a place, Mami Bay, and their heroin stash is surely running low in supply. Now, December 3rd, 23rd to January 4th involves Mick and Bianca. They're focused on the Nicaraguan earthquake that devastated Bianca's country, her origin country. So they had to fly down there and help support distribution of typhoid injections and medical supplies. While all this was going on, there was times where they were planning a Pacific Coast tour in the middle of all this, and they were going to go to Hawaii, Australia, New Zealand, Japan. And what wind up happening on January 9th, Japan decides they want to ban Mick Jagger from entering the country because of his past drug convictions. So tickets were on sale. They were sold out, Budokan, and they had to cancel these shows. And the Japanese government didn't want them in. And the fans were refunded, and of course, very upset.
Why was the visa in Japan denied or not granted?
Well, the visa was not granted because I had a drug conviction in 1969, but in October they said that they would... They wouldn't worry about that because, as here, I mean, the rule is that you can't come in, but if it's only a marijuana conviction, they tend to, give you a waiver if they're kind enough to do so. And they would do that. That's what they said they'd do in October. And 10 days ago, they just said, no, you can't come because you're too well known. So I said, because I'm too well known. So they said, yeah, because you're too well known. So I said, thank you. I wish you'd told me in October, because we wouldn't have sold the tickets.
Around this time also, during Goat's Head Soup, Mick Taylor has been expressing to several people about his displeasure of being with the Stones and his creativity being stunted. He didn't like spending 10 hours on one track that he could really master in 3 hours. So that's been brewing and leading up to eventually his request to depart. Now, January 16th to the 18th in 1973, the Stones hold rehearsals. And where are they? They flew to SIR Studios in Los Angeles. So January 18th, the Stones decided, and I believe it was with Bill Graham, to perform a benefit concert. It's a concert for the Nicaraguan earthquake victims at the LA Forum with Santana and also Cheech and Chong. And they raised about $500,000 there. January 20th, the Rolling Stones fly to Hawaii and they start their Australian Pacific tour, or they also called it the East Winter Tour. And on the 21st and 22nd of January, they had 3 shows in Honolulu, Hawaii, with ZZ Top opening for him.
The word was that Jagger had heard our stuff and he liked it, and asked if we wanted to play with the Stones open for them in Hawaii. You got to understand, I love and always have the Rolling Stones. I mean, I just flew.
That was just great, you know, because we weren't anybody. You know, to get to go to Hawaii for one thing and to open for the Stones, you know, for 3 shows, that was amazing.
We decided we're going to go over 2 weeks in advance, and it was all under the guise of, we're going to warm up. Well, the only warming up we did was, you know, walking Waikiki Beach and getting some suntan.
Charlie Watts sat at the poolside bar probably about 12 hours a day. I mean, he was a fixture at that bar. Keith Richards wore white pants that were as dirty as you can possibly get them. He wore the same pants all 3 nights.
We did 3 shows in 2 days, but I had heard that on this same tour, Stevie Wonder was on one of the shows and actually got booed. Stevie Wonder. And so I was scared shitless. I mean, I really was. And we walked on stage the first show. We had cowboy hats on and boots and jeans, and you could hear a pin drop.
When the curtains opened and they looked at Billy and Dusty, you know, and they had the cowboy hats on, there just a veil of horror fell over this entire, you know, arena. It was like, oh, fuck, a country band.
And I turned to Frank and Dusty. I said, all right, fellas, we got to hit it.
Mick watched us. He dressed up. He put on like a hat and some coveralls and stood on the side of the stage with a broom like a janitor and watched us play.
I look over the side and I see Jagger looking at us again, but he's got a broom turned upside down like a beard standing. So he's got a pretty good sense of humor. It was so much fun, I can't tell you. we got an encore each show. An encore. I mean, I was just on cloud 29.
Those three performances were just electric. We did our job, same bluesy thing that got us together in the first place. It settled the score, and this wave of enjoyment permeated through that whole arena.
Next day, I was sitting at the airport and I was reading the paper. They didn't mention this. I mean, absolutely nothing. Almost worse than saying you're crappy or they don't like you is just dismiss you. That happened a lot to us.
As far as the journalists and the press in general was concerned, they couldn't understand us.
And the set list was very similar to the benefit show. No goat's head soup material, but sort of the Exile and Sticky and some Let It Bleed and some older songs also. Now, January 27th, with the cancellation of the Japanese show and those dates, they flew back right after Hawaii, back to L.A. to Village Recorder Studios. And they worked on several tracks from Goat's Head Soup, including Star Star and Dancing with Mr. D and others. On February 6th, the Stones fly to Sydney, Australia. And February 9th, they hold a press conference.
There is a story going around that someone tried to smuggle some pot into the country. Is that
who did? What kind of pot?
I don't understand.
Shame pot, or is that? I don't understand the question. It's not true.
I don't understand the question.
I thought the question was quite plain enough.
Someone was trying to know. I don't understand the question.
Sure. Pot. Sure.
No, I'm very sorry, sir. There was nobody trying to smuggle pot into the country. Phone up anybody you want.
Mr. Bresley, our immigration minister the other day.
Ask him. Phone him up.
Defended you very.
Never said in that story. It never said. So, you know, if you start on that, you know, that's why I was so rude to you, because you started on that. If you want to follow up in TV journalism what rubbish they dish out in the press, then you're pretty low.
Just take me from the back there, don't you?
So watch out, boy.
And then February 11th to the 27th, they perform in Auckland, New Zealand, then Brisbane, Melbourne, Adelaide, Perth, and Sydney. And there are some bootlegs also of these shows. February 28th, that was vacation time. Mick and Keith go back to Jamaica. Mick Taylor flies to Hong Kong. Bill and Ian Stewart stay in L.A. Where does Charlie go? He goes back home to France. In March of 73, while Keith was away, Anita started to get off heroin. When he returned, he got her started back and then doing it again, just as bad as it was. Some of his friends who were nice before started acting very bitchy to Anita now. Keith had a Jamaican entourage of hanger-oners. He was living in Ochos Rios now. And these hanger-oners were always around the house, leaving absolutely no privacy for he and Anita. And they would come over and just stay. And they basically, yes, Keith, to death. Anything you say, Keith. There was no personal time. And heroin was the only thing Anita and Keith had in common at this point. And this was their beginning of the end. Keith had bought the Point of View mansion in Ochos Rios. And that overlooked Cutlass Bay. Bill, he had purchased land in Vence, France, and he was building his new home. In April and May time frame, Keith returns to London, as he was allowed to go back. That same day, Anita was arrested when their Ochos Rios house was raided. She was arrested for ganja possession. They threw her in a cell with other male prisoners. and supposedly she was beaten and repeatedly raped. It took about $10,000 of cash bribe to get her out. I think she was in about 3 days. When she arrived in London, she was badly bruised. The doctor at Keith's Cheyenne Walk location home confirmed this. There was evidence of multiple rape. They wound up staying at the Cheyenne Walk location. June 27th, 1973. Keith's most famous drug bust, but walked away with a 250-pound fine for 25 charges. That was it. It was so obvious, even to the judge, that the Chelsea drug squad were trying to get him. They found some grass, some resin, some Chinese heroin, some Mandrax tabs, burnt spoons, syringes, and some water pipes and scales. Also a .38 revolver and a shotgun and some rounds of ammunition. Seems like a good bust. But Keith and Anita still asleep when awakened by the raid. And what happened was, when Keith came to the door telling them Marshall Chess was renting the house, they were just staying overnight after a late night finish to a long recording session. "Has nothing to do with us," Keith said. He rents the place from Keith. He said that he did own the place and he did not have a license for the guns. Keith also said that the revolver was for protection in Jamaica and was bought for him by a roadie, Leroy Leonard. He said he only fired it once just to test it, and that was it, never used. The shotgun, well, that shotgun was just an old child's miniature antique gun. It was made by a French nobleman back in the 1880s. At the trial, the police tried to get him as it was a sawed-off shotgun, which a sawed-off shotgun had an automatic one-year prison sentence. Keith pleaded not guilty to this charge, but the others he did not. The police action got the judge angry that he slapped Keith with a 10-pound fine for each charge, 25 charges. The revolver, short barrel under 24-inch, had not been used and was also in poor condition. And despite the variety of drugs found, it was a real small amount of drugs found. May to July 73, Mick and Keith start hanging out with Ronnie Wood at his house. And actually, Mick Taylor knew Ronnie first. He knew him when he was 15 years old, and they would jam when he was with the Birds. And Mick Taylor would go out, and so would Mick and Keith, and they knew Rod first before they knew Ronnie, but they were introduced, and they would hang out and jam. May 23rd to June 20th, 1973. The Stones continue recording, mixing, overdub sessions at Olympic Island Studios in London. They also ended their association with longtime phenomenon producer Jimmy Miller. Jimmy was born in Brooklyn, New York, 1942. His dad owned a nightclub up in Fort Lee, New Jersey. Pretty state-of-the-art. The Rat Pack would show up, and the club was well-to-do. It was finally knocked down when the Palisades Parkway was built. And what his father did was head to Vegas, became an entertainment director at Sahara Hotel, and he brought in the Las Vegas lounges. He also brought in Elvis in 69. He did a lot for Las Vegas. Now, there are many stories and background on Jimmy. He was a cheerful, easygoing personality, but the Stones, they got to him. They sucked him into their problems. Keith said that Jimmy went in like a lion and he came out a lamb. We wore him out completely. He just melted into the dope and alcohol addiction. Now, his mom did have the alcohol addiction also. He was amazing in his art. He encouraged experimentation and outside-the-box thinking to the band. He sang and also played drums. Keith loved how he knew how to groove. He took the Stones to their best years of their musical life. He was behind the most pivotal song the Stones ever did, Jumpin' Jack Flash. He also worked with Beggars, Let It Bleed, Sticky, Exile, Goat's Head Soup. Who can forget the cowbell? He changed Sympathy for the Devil from a folky song to a samba rhythmic groovy song. His contributions, the lyrics, you can't always get what you want. And that was Mr. Jimmy. He played on Happy drums. He did Shine a Light. Did the outro of Tumbling Dice. Did a lot of percussion. What I marvel about this unsung Stones hero, all those albums sounded different. Nothing sounded alike. Same producer, different environments, but didn't sound alike. That is just, it's just unheard of, and what I credit brilliance most to Jimmy. He passed due to heroin issues to his body in October 94. He was 52 years old. In July of 73, Keith was spending time at Redlands now, his place in Sussex, a home he purchased in 1966 for £20,000. July 4th, Mick and Bianca attend Bowie's Ziggy retirement party at Café Royal in London with Lou Reed, Paul McCartney, Ringo, Jeff Beck, Keith Moon, Streisand. And there was that famous picture of Mick, Lou, and Bowie from there. On July 19th, the Stones shoot promotional film clips for Angie, Silver Train, Dancing with Mr. D in London. July 26th, Jagger turns 30 years old. July 30th, a fire erupts at Redlands, and Keith and Anita and the kids get out safely. And the roof had caught fire. Another disaster for Keith. Mid-August 1973, Mick and Keith mix Star Star at Sound Plush Studio in the Netherlands. August 17th, the first single, Angie, is released in the UK. And August 28th, it's in the US. August 31st, the Stones release their 11th UK studio album. And their 13th U.S. album on September 12th, Goat's Head Soup. September 1st to 4th on 73, they launched their 1973 European tour starting in Vienna, Austria. September 19th, Graham Parson dies, drugs at Joshua Tree. October 19th, the Stones end their European tour in West Berlin. And it's the last concert with Mick Taylor as a Stone. For November 13th, 1973, go check out my It's Only Rock and Roll album review video.